Hello, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the yet another episode of NHRD Bangalore chapter, our Thought Leadership Monthly Meet. Is the screen visible? Hi, Shivashri Pallavi?
No, it's not visible.
Now,
not at much. No.
Maybe someone else can try sharing the screen and she can speak.
I don't know. I can see it on my screen. I'm not too sure why you guys cannot see the screen.
Maybe I think it might be loading much. Because it says waiting to view my screen.
Okay, we'll figure that out, and probably a little later we'll try and see how we can get the screen. Sorry for that, guys, but let's start with a good note that I want to share, that as an EC, we complete first year in the Bangalore EC team this month. Been an exciting year of different events that we have done, and a lot of different events, from monthly meets to HR showcase to different programs for students in the conference team, certification program, etc., that we have done. Last 3 months being, due to the current situation, a lot of virtual connects and programs that we have done. We've had over 2,000 people who have participated in our different events, be it the learning sessions, casual, meetups that we just did. In fact, we just tried our virtual networking a while ago on a different platform. Monthly meet, this is our fourth monthly meet on a virtual platform that we've hosted. And again, we have about close to 2,000 people who've been a part of with these monthly meets, and looking forward to many more, probably like this, keeping in mind the situation that we have on that. A quick note on Bangalore chapter. One of the most of the vibrant chapters that I would say that we are a part of it. A lot of different initiatives that we do, from Bangalore chapter, and a lot more coming across in the coming years. So if you guys are not members as yet, I would surely recommend that you should look at becoming a member. There's a lot of benefits available being a member. We have about over 13,000 members across the 30 chapters in India available. Bangalore itself has about 2,500 members that are currently. If you already have a membership, which is either annual, silver, or gold, you could convert that to a lifetime by paying a difference before it expires. For more details, you can log on to our website, which is nhrdbangalore.com. Different types of membership available for an individual, to a student, to institutional, etc. on that. There are two exciting programs that we have coming up in the month of July. I'm not too sure if you guys would have seen it. We've done emailers and social media campaigns onto it. One is on the analytics certification, workplace analytics. That's happening on a virtual platform. We also have something called as a speed mentoring, the virtual speed mentoring for young HR professionals, which is only for members. So do log into our website, nhrdbangalore.com, and look at the details. There's very something interesting that NHRD is launching, and happy to share about it on this platform today, which is NHRD Inclusion Lab, which Chris Shankar, Shradhanjali Rao, and Brigo Joshi have kind of put this entire model together, which is all towards D&I, you know. And we are looking to pilot with about 8 to 10 organizations in the country currently. And this is going to be completely free with the organization. There are different models and platforms available onto it. And we'll kind of, you know, this model will probably help the organization to look at currently at what stage of D&I they are and how they can, you know, grow in that particular format under that. And coming to our today's monthly meet that we are all geared up here for, keeping in mind the June, the Pride month, we thought let's have something in lines of that. And looking at it, probably we thought hiring is the first piece where in the organization where probably a lot of systems and things need to become in place. And that's how we kind of looked at it, you know, designing an inclusive hiring system or the entire ecosystem around it. So without further delay, I would like to invite Shivashree, who's our host and the moderator for this evening, for this exciting session that we are all gathered here for. Shivashree, over to you.
Thank you much. So first of all, I would like to extend my warm welcome to our esteemed panel and all our participants who have joined in for the session. It's my honor to be your moderator for today. So before kickstarting the session, I would like to give a short introduction about myself. So hi, I'm Shivashree. I'm working as HR business partner with CSG, and I have overall 5+ years of corporate experience. So before CSG, I was associated with Wipro, and also I'm part of NHRD Young Advisory Board. So today we have in our panel Shefali, who is a group head from Group Head Rewards and Recognition in Godrej, and we have Savita, who is a TA head from ThoughtWorks, and we have Dennis, who is TA head from Intuit. So I would request the panel to give a short introduction.
Sure. Can I go first? Yeah, hi. Hi, everyone. Warm welcome to this webinar, and thank you for joining. Thank you, NHRD team, for inviting me to this webinar. I'm really looking forward to talk here and very happy to be here as well. First of all, congratulations on the completion of a year of this team, and also kudos to all of you for doing this wonderful work of bringing the whole HR community together. So by just way of introduction, my name is Savita. I head up recruitment for ThoughtWorks in India. I am with ThoughtWorks for over 5 years, and I'm close to about 20 years of experience in the recruitment space, mostly in the tech space, and I worked with most of the IT majors. So ThoughtWorks is a global software consultancy company, and we have about over 2,000 people in India, and we're located in 7 different locations in India. And yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, so Shefali, can you please go?
Hi, sure, thanks, Shivashree. Hi, my name is Shefali. I work with Godrej. I'm the group head rewards diversity as well as people productivity. I've been with Godrej for about 3 years, prior to which I was with the Aditya Birla Group for about 12 years, primarily in the space of rewards. So yeah, looking forward to the session today and exchanging notes with all of you.
Okay. Hi, Dennis.
Hi, good evening, everyone. This is Dennis here. My apologies, my video is not working. It's some technical issue. Sorry about that. I've been with Intuit for over 4 years now, managing the talent acquisition there for Lateral. Been in the industry for a very long time. I worked with Savita and a lot of the people in the industry. Something which people are not aware of me is I'm a certified football coach, and I've been a trainer for a long time now. So that's what I do away from work. So that's it about me. And thanks for invite NHRD, and congratulations once again for your 1 year.
Thank you. So so today, team, we will go ahead with Q&A format. It will be, the session would be 60 to 70 odd minutes. So let's kickstart the session with Savita. Hi, Savita. So the first question is for you. So the diversity and inclusion starts at recruitment for every organization, as you know. So what are the different sources your organization leverages to hire employees in LGBTQ space? And also, what are the major challenges you face to hire and retain them?
Yeah, sure. So thanks for an extremely great question. For us, diversity and inclusion, like any other company, starts at recruitment. And not just for the inclusivity in the LGBTQ space, but also in diversity. So we focus on hiring for grads as well as laterals. Some of the things what we do in ThoughtWorks is that we are not just focused on gender diversity, but we also look at multi-generational diversity. We look at geographical diversity when we hire people. We also look at hiring people from the LGBTQ community as well. So at a campus level, for a very long time, we have had a 50% gender target, and that's been going on for over 5 years now. We ensure that all the grads what we hire from campus, we have 50% women in that. Then when it comes to geographical diversity, we don't focus on just hiring people from metros and from the tier one cities and tier one schools. We go out and hire people from tier two, tier three cities. And Northeast India is one place where we have been hiring successfully. And we have great talent out there. It's over 4 years now, and we've had some extremely good talent what we have got from the Northeastern states. And when we talk about women, we also hire, we have specific programs, which one of it is known as WAPSI. I'll talk to you a little more about it later. So this is about bringing women in tech who are on a break for family reasons back into the workforce. We also have a 20-month program called STEP, which focuses on hiring candidates at a grad level, but from tier two, tier three cities, and who are non-engineering grads. These are people who have completed the diploma in engineering, the three-year diploma after their 10th or 12th standard. And we have a 20-month in-house training program for them, where they get a stipend, they get to work, and they get to learn. It's a full-time program, and they also get to do a BCA from one of the government-recognized universities as well as a part of this program. So we have got some phenomenal talent coming out of this STEP program, and they are some of the most sought-after engineers inside the company. We're in the LGBTQ space as well, we are doing quite a lot to tap into this talent pool. For example, we have partnerships with Periphery, which is a social startup, which helps in bringing job opportunities for transgender persons. We have worked with them to come up with a program, a corporate training program, which will help transgender individuals find jobs within corporate setups. We work with Solidarity Foundation. And then we also had this program called Interning with Pride, where we look at tech candidates or people who have a technology background from the LGBTQ community who can come and work with us for about 5 months, intern with us rather. And at the end of the internship, we offer them jobs because they really did well. And we also help them learn as well as giving them an opportunity to work in a corporate setup. So one of the things what we believe in is that we need to build an inclusive employer brand, and just hiring people from LGBTQ space or from different backgrounds is not going to be enough. So that is something what we focus on, because other than hiring, building a safe work environment for them, giving equal opportunities for growth once they come in, and also having a workforce which is sensitive to the communities and to the needs of this community is something what we strive for. So all this helps us in tapping into the talent, and also it spreads a good word of mouth. And there's also a lot of inbounds coming in. It's not that we need to go out and look. People know that ThoughtWorks has a great environment for people from different diverse backgrounds, and people come to us. So this is quite a lot of relentless work, what we have been doing for the last 4 to 5 years. And even much before hiring people from LGBTQ community was known in the industry. So quickly on the challenges piece, one is, of course, the whole acceptance, right? The people are scared. I mean, there's so much of homophobia in the society today that people are not willing to come out of the closet or talk about it. And so that's the biggest challenge of getting people out and helping them to come and seek opportunities with us, or go out and try and help them, get opportunities with us as well. And as when and in terms of gender diversity, the problem in tech is pretty well known. The number of women who pick up STEM studies itself from the school onwards is very less. So the funnel is very, it's very wide at the top, and as it goes down, it gets very narrow. So finding women who take up STEM studies, who want to work in tech itself, is very less. And also a lot of women start their work in tech, but after some time they take a break for family reasons, or trailing spouses, and all those issues come up, and they just fall off the grid. So we have to figure out, how do you bring these women back to work? Where do you go and tap this talent? All right, those are some of the challenges. At a grassroots level, definitely there's a lot of challenge of actually finding this talent, what we really need.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Savita. I believe that is a lot of unique sources that you are leveraging to hire employees, and particularly in LGBT space. Yeah. Thank you. That was quite informative. So hi, Dennis. So let's go with the next question with you. So as you know, June being a Pride Month, there are a lot of celebration which is happening across organization and different industries. So recently, if you have seen, a Pride Circle have hosted a 21-day challenge program where people from globally participated, competed, and it's to create more awareness for a behavioral change. So would love to hear some of the celebration that happened in your organization as a part of Pride Month.
Sure, Shri. We started off the month by a talk by our leader, Sasan, who's a CEO. Okay. He spoke about what Intuit is, and the panel members were the leaders of the organization. Had Scott Beth, who has come out, and he has come out long back, and he's one of the HR leader for us. We had the head of Israeli side, part of the panel. And then, of course, we had a head of HR who was part of the panel discussion. So we kickstarted the whole month with the discussion on what is Intuit doing about LGBT, and how are we supporting the community, and not just the LGBT community, but also the ally from an organization perspective. So that was an amazing session for the organization, for the employees to see how leaders are supporting this, because it has to come from top down. That's the only way people will be able to appreciate and understand that the company supports it. It was amazing to see Sasan coming and sharing his personal story about him, about his daughter. So that was a very inspiring thing. And of course, Scott Beth, who is a leader for diversity and inclusion at Intuit, who is also one of the speakers at UNO on the LGBT community. So they spoke very well and they kickstarted it. Apart from that, each location had their own events, and we are in 13 different locations. Different countries, and we had different events organized. Coming to India, we had an amazing session. We had every day one program aligned, starting from reading and coming out of the story of an LGBT community, appraise yourself on something on the LGBT, introspect why you are striving to be an ally, learn about the laws around LGBT. So this was all was done to kind of create awareness within the organization. As some of you are aware, Intuit is one of the first companies to start and support LGBT community. Srini, who's right now heading the Pride Circle, was the leader for DNI and at Intuit. He did an amazing job. First company to come out with a gender neutral washroom. We are the first company to come out with a policy where if any employee who wants to change their sex, we provide them with insurance. We have HR in India. We have people in the organization who have come out. So these are things which are, which are very supportive for the other employees, and they're open to coming out. We have, Madhu was one of the speakers in this month, where she came and spoke about what is LGBT and how people should be, supporting this community and what are the challenges they go through. So these are some of the things we did. We had a movie, and considering that we are under lockdown, there was a huge participation from the employees. We were surprised to see a lot of people coming and asking questions, and they were really open about challenges, how do we support, how if someone wants to come out, what do they have to do. So those are things which really help. Actually, this month really helped in a lot of awareness, creating brand, getting to know what Intuit is doing specifically for our employees. So I think this is a very good awareness month, and a lot of people were appreciative of that. And since they were working from home, I felt that this was a great opportunity for people to come out and spend that time in the offices where people were working busy on the desk, they were not able to come. I thought this was a great opportunity because the lockdown was perfect situation for people to spend some time and get to know what is happening. So that is what we did, and it was very, very productive month for us.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, so, Dennis. Sorry, Shefali. Please Sivishi, go ahead.
I wanted to just add a few things to what Dennis was talking about from a Godrej standpoint. So, and while you talked about the Pride Month, our ethos has been that we celebrate Pride through the year, because of course through the India Culture Lab, which Parmesh heads for us, and so many events through them. So they obviously have a concept of Friday, Fun Fridays, and every Friday there is an event. So of course, multiple of those, at least once a month, is a Pride event where we would talk about the LGBTQ community. Parmesh has obviously finished writing his book, We Are a Stan, and there's a lot about that that we talk about to our employees as well. What else does happen is that in our leadership forum, so when we are talking to the because that's where the influencing needs to happen, we don't restrict it to the Pride Month, but say April is our usual leadership forum season, and we do have themes around Pride. So themes around LGBTQ, sometimes we'll call it the XX factor, and then talk about difficult subject, because at the end of the day, it's the leadership that we need to be able to influence to help them alleviate any biases that they may have and any barriers that may be creating to be able to hire or sustain through with the community within the organization. And therefore, we had the UNDP come and launch their code of conduct from Godrej premises. And of course, we have all the idols of the LGBTQ community come and be there with us. Again, a lot of community is invited to the workplace, as well as employees get to experience and know that we are so much ahead of the curve on the subject, and therefore the comfort that it builds. Similarly, the Culture Lab prepared the trans inclusion paper, and that was launched for the community and of course for corporates to use as a resource. Parallel to that, similar to what Dennis was talking about, we did launch our gender affirmation policy. This was back in 2018. But through these years, month on month, the initiatives on the celebration of being part of the community and being inclusive of the community is something that we want to make business as usual rather than restricted to a specific month. So that's how we are trying to build that together.
Yeah. Thanks, Shefali. You know, I did understand, you know, Paresh has been hosting different events talking about diversity and inclusion with different companies about the Godrej practices. And thank you so much for the input. And Dennis, I do agree with you, as you rightly mentioned, you know, because one of the recent study by McKinsey state that there is a strong correlation between the diversity in the teams and the company's financial performance. In fact, that is that next question which is coming up. When the leaders are aligned, and I'm sure there is a difference that has been made to our employees. Thank you, Dennis. Savita, as I you know, as I mentioned, you know, given that there is a lot of things that is happening in your organization in terms of diversity and inclusion space, would love to hear some of the unique programs that has been happening in your organization.
Yeah, sure, thanks. So let me talk first on the diversity piece, and then I'll also talk on the inclusive space as well. So we have a very award-winning program called Vapsi, which is Bring Her Back to Work program. This was launched about 5 years ago in a small manner, but then we relaunched it about 3 years ago in a bigger way. This is basically for to bring women in technology who are on break back into the workforce. So what we realized is a lot of women in technology who take a break, when they come back, they look for non-technical jobs because technology moves so fast that it's hard for them to catch up. It's hard for them to come back. They lose the confidence whether they'll be able to pick up all the new technologies and be able to be a part of the workforce. So our focus was more on bringing women back to tech. And that is why we launched this program called Vapsi. This is a program where we go out and look for women with 3+ years of work experience, have taken a break and want to come back. We ran a small entry interview and a test for them. And we run them through a intensive full-time 4 to 5 weeks training program within ThoughtWorks. It is run by ThoughtWorkers. It is designed by us. It is conceptualized and designed by us. It's a full-time training program, which will help them bridge the gap or brush up their technical skills. We also help them in building some of the soft skills, giving them the confidence. And then we pick students who really perform well in that and give them an internship of about a paid internship for about 3 to 5 months. And based on their performance, we also convert them into full-time thought workers at the end of the program. So the goal of this program is not just for hiring for ThoughtWorks, but it is also about building the confidence in the women to get back to work. A lot of women who do not get the opportunities to work with us also have found gainful employment outside of ThoughtWorks in the technical space. And the impact has been really great, and that's been recognized by a lot of people. And a lot of women want to come back. And while we started off in a small manner in our Bangalore office, now we have conducted these programs successfully in all the other offices as well. So the collective impact has been really great, and that is something what we're very proud about, rather than just hiring for us. So that's been one of the very successful programs we're running, and we ran about 8 to 9 such programs last year, and we would be doing this year as well. The other one, as I talked about, was a STEP program where we look at bringing non-engineering graduates into the technology workforce. So we look for students who have completed a diploma from tier 2, tier 3 cities. They go through an interview process and then a 20-month full-fledged program, which is a paid, where we pay stipend as well for them. And at the end of it, they get converted into entry-level graduate consultants, or we give them the same compensation in the same role what any other campus grad would get. So this has been running successfully as well, and this has helped us to successfully tap talent from various parts of India and different type of background. So other than this, we also hire from the northeastern states. So this helps in building a lot of geographical diversity into the company, and very good talent as well. So hiring 15% women from campus has been our goal for a very long time. And also, as a goal, we also want to hire 40% women and underrepresented minorities in ThoughtWorks by the end of 2021. So this is mostly in for the diversity space, and for the inclusion, like I said, we have a program called Interning with Pride, where we look for offering internship opportunities, the 5-month internship opportunities for students who are from the LGBTQ community, and at the end of it, we also offer jobs for them. And then we also work with organizations like Periphery in order to tap talent and help in providing job opportunities for transgenders and people. So ThoughtWorks has been a pioneer in this space for a very long time. In fact, we hired our first transgender employees almost about 8 or 9 years ago. And we have always been vocal about and supporting that community as well. So in 2014, our MDs wrote an open letter asking for a revoking of the Article 377, much long before other industries or other people actually talked about it. So we are, all our policies are process, we are very people over processes in terms of our policies. So the, what all we do in areas of, we do work for inclusion and diversity in hiring, in our policies, in our leadership training programs, whether it's for women, for women in leadership development programs, and providing opportunities for mentorship and training for women. We look for 50% representation in all our leadership development programs, and we need to have that many women. We do not start a program if we don't have 50% women. So those are some of the things what we do. Some of the other progressive policies what we have are, the 6-month in maternity leave was a policy which was in ThoughtWorks long before the government adopted it. We have been having this for a very long time. Then our medical policy also covers gender affirmation and transition. It covers same-sex partners as well. So other than this, what we also do within ThoughtWorks is we have a lot of internal groups, FM groups. We have something called a group called Mitra Collective, which is an internal group, which is an affinity group to support the LGBTQ individuals inside ThoughtWorks, and this consists of people from members of the community plus other thought workers as well. We help in, this is a very employee driven one. It was just set up by like people or employees who got together and said we should do something in this space. So we have all these affinity groups inside which helps in running unconscious bias programs, which they also help in running sensitization programs. We have a full-fledged D&I team which handles all these issues. So a lot of work done in the, in the D&I space here. And other than that, of course, we have the mental health support for employees and the families as well inside ThoughtWorks. I'm sorry, you're on mute.
Sorry, Savita. There was some technical glitch. I do understand that there are a lot of diversity. We are taking a collective method to, and using different, leveraging different sources to bring in the talent, right? I came across one of the interesting statements, say that diversity does not necessarily mean inclusion, right? And what are some of the ways that we make our employees aware of the implicit biases, and how are we building an inclusive culture in our organization? So Samita or Shefali, anybody can take it up.
Shefali, you want to take that?
Sure, Samita. I'll try to attempt, and then you can probably help me. So I think for us, and I think we're just very fortunate to have the leadership buy-in, because the whole a piece around LGBTQ in particular, and of course on inclusion in general around diversity, starts from the top. So Nisaba Godrej is the biggest sponsor that we have, and for a very long time D&I as a portfolio used to report directly to her. And even now, the number of times the reviews happen, the diversity council set up, the number of metrics that we follow as an organization to ensure that inclusion is at the helm of everything, and we can tap into wherever gaps start to tend to emerge. Because again, it's very important to see that you know, there are lots. We are a microcosm in a larger society, where people are who they are with their belief systems and the way they have grown up and their own experiences. So when they come to the organization, how do we ensure and induct them into the policies and structures and the culture that we have in the organization, and how do we communicate to them around what is non-negotiable, so to say, is that becomes very, very important. So if, we measure, we track inclusion quotient on a regular basis. So even managers where inclusion quotients come as for lower scores, because again, I think inclusion is not just important from having a certain set of communities represented. We have a very large millennial workforce, and we get valued and desired as an organization because we are high on inclusion. And I think that itself makes us a much better business case, because people know that, you know what, this organization from a culture standpoint encourages inclusion and ensures that it exists in every facet. So therefore, inclusion quotient is tracked even at a manager level, and wherever those scores tend to drop, stringent action is taken, enough effort is done to figure where the gap has emerged and what do we do to rectify it, whether it's in the manager related or it's the behavior patterns which are not being manifested appropriately by the environment in general. The other important piece around that is also to do with metrics. Like, we can say that, okay, and you know, like Savitha did talk about, that inclusion starts at the time of hiring, but what do you do after hiring? How do I sustain them through in the organization? That culture is also very important. So what's happening on my bell curve, for that matter, as an example? So am I seeing some biases crop up there? Or am I checking on, so every process in the organization, is it having a fair share of my various communities or not? If that is anywhere the gap, then that shows that, you know, like I'm not being able to live the value that I'm actually manifesting and speaking about or preaching, so to say, and therefore the need to practice it becomes even more eminent. And to keep that sustaining is actually a much tougher task, you know, probably getting people into the organization, selling them the thought process is still one part of the journey accomplished, but ensuring that they sustain through, and the EVP commitment that we've made to them in terms of our proposition is being maintained and sustained, I think becomes an equally tough task. So that's one way of really tightly ensuring that we are measuring the metrics, ensuring that we know which microcosm is the gap coming in, and how are we actively supporting that particular manager to rectify personal behaviors or the external environment behaviors, whatever is causing that implication, and thereby having the highest authority in the organization monitor through a diversity council on various of these metrics, whether it's attrition, whether it's engagement, or whether it's just hiring for that matter, or sourcing.
Thank you, Shefali.
So just if may add, I think a big plus one to all what Shefali has said, I think it really makes sense, and that's something what we are very cognizant about in ThoughtWorks as well. For us, our diversity and inclusion strategy falls in four different buckets. The first one is, of course, of finding the diverse talent, which is the first part of it, but it doesn't end there. Then we look at the retention and the policies. What kind of policies do we have? Understanding what are the industry best practices, participating in inclusion studies, and then giving flexible work options, remuneration, minimizing the gender pay gap. There's so many issues around that. And then we about the advancement opportunities. What about leadership development programs? What kind of, do we have a clear growth and development path for them? Do we invest enough in their capability development? What kind of mentorship? What kind of training? All these are areas what we focus on once we hire this kind of a diverse talent inside the company. Then for inclusion, of course, we conduct workshops called Being Inclusive. It's kind of a mandatory for all the thought workers to go through it. And we foster a safe and inclusive culture right? Having affinity groups like the Spitra Collective, Women and ThoughtWorks, then having mental health and wellness groups and mental health and wellness programs. All these things help us in building an inclusive work environment. Because once it's just hiring is not enough, you know, we have to make sure that it is imbibed and the culture of the organization changes to make it a very diverse and inclusive workspace and a safe workspace for people to come in. And all the people who we hire from these various diverse backgrounds and different types of different segments of society are also absorbed and become a part of the fabric of the organization. So that is something what we strive for. And we have a diversity inclusion team as well, which is like they really do a lot in the space to ensure that this is taken care of once they are, once we hire them and bring them inside the company.
Yeah. Yes, I do agree, Savita and Shefali, because I think most of the organization who are diversity winners are, specifically focusing on, once the talent is into the organization, how are they free from the biases and how open is the culture and how transparent are we in terms of the processes and everything. Yeah. So thank you for that input. So Savita, one other question. What are the biggest workplace challenges that you foresee for the LGBTQ space? And also, do you think the current situation with COVID have augmented these challenges?
Yeah, that's a good question. So very less, a few organizations are actually friendly to the LGBTQ plus community. So it is still frowned upon, although there is a lot of acceptance after, the scrapping of the Article 377. But even then, the need to hide the identity is very high in that community. And there's a lot of discrimination and homophobia what they face and in society in general and also at the workspaces. So these are few of the important, biggest challenges what they face. The acceptance of people is not there. The acceptance in society is not there, and that translates at the workplace as well. So there's a lot that needs to be done in that area in terms of the challenges for this community. And also, in this situation, in the COVID situation, what has happened is everyone is homebound and people are living with their own family. And living with the family is a bigger issue for them because the homophobia and the violence starts at home in most of these cases. There's no acceptance in the home itself. And it just puts them into a lot of stress. And there is a lot of mental health issues what they face. If you talk about the trans community, they're always living under constant fear. And there's also a fear that if they test positive for COVID, then will the hospitals even accommodate them? What happens to them when they go to the hospital? Will they get treated? So this kind of anxiety and stress levels within this community, I understand, has really increased. Of course, there are fortunate people who can get to see counselors and can talk to people. But then they have limited privacy at homes, especially if they have not come out of their closet. Then they cannot, or living in a shared accommodation. It's very hard for them to really cope up with this kind of stress. So the anxiety, stress, and are the biggest challenges what I think the community is facing right now because of being homebound and remote work, not being able to go and meet people. Because if they come to work, they at least have a set of people who are their allies or who support them, and they feel most safer in these work environments rather than stay at home and face homophobia at home as well.
Okay. Thank you, Savita. So today, a lot of organizations who are diversity winners are leveraging technology to drive the LGBT. The focus is more data driven and using analytical tools. So can you please brief the role of how technology is enabling you to drive your organization to take a data driven decisions? So Dennis, I would love to hear your views on this.
Sure. When we talk about data or when we talk about technology, in the beginning of any organization you look at, you're looking at hiring people, right? Once you look into the organization and see what is the kind of diversity you have, and then generally it comes to the talent acquisition team to say, hey, this is the area where we need to focus. This is the area where we need to bring in more candidates, and we need to focus on those. So what we do is, rather we are looking at how do we brand our organization as an LGBT supportive or ally organization. So we have a talent branding team at Intuit, where we reach out through various channels. One is the LinkedIn, what we use. Then we use a lot of webinars and a lot of other channels, our career sites. Okay. We have our info site where we constantly keep sharing information. But what the talent marketing team does is talks about how Intuit is supporting the LGBTQ community, or any diverse for that matter, veterans. In the US, we talk about different ethnicity. So we reach out to different set of people through different channels and show them what we are doing at Intuit. That's how we've been using our platform, our technology to reach out to these people. Apart from that, we also host seminar. In this month, we have done a lot of events through Zoom or through webinars or through other channels to kind of do discuss about our leaders are going and talking, are they doing social events. So we're using different platforms depending on which country we are. From a data perspective, yes, data is one, medium where we try to find out what kind of, how many people are there in the industry and how many we can hire, what skill set it is. So I for me personally and for Intuit, data is only just a measure. And the more we spend time or more we use our energy is to kind of share information about Intuit so that employees or candidates with diverse background would come and join us. We don't really go and advertise saying that, hey, we have this policy or we have this policy, Y policy from an LGBT community, but we only just, when the candidates come and talk to us, we say, hey, what is the options we have? How is the organization supporting? We throw those information out, and of course, all the information is there in the career site or wherever you go and check on the Intuit perspective. So that is how we've been utilizing some of our platform, some of our employees, some of our leadership team, and it is a top-down approach. You know, our leaders are driving it. When we see our leaders driving it, the employees feel comfortable opening and talking about it, and our employee referral has been the highest. 35% of our hires come through employee referrals, and the reason being is we share everything with them and they are comfortable talking to people with their family, the friends, and that's how it's been coming. So that is how we've been doing at Intuit.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Dennis. Recently, if you have seen, Unilever have celebrated its 50-50 gender ratio at the management level, and they quoted one of the initiative on stereotype, where they moved advertisement away from the stereotype, recognizing that it is outdated and unhelpful. Right. So similarly, can you please talk about some of the significant milestones achieved by your organizations and the programs which is being supporting to it? Shefali or Savita?
Savita, why don't you take that first?
Sure, thanks. Okay, that's a great question. So what happened was about 4 years ago, we were trying to hire more women in tech, which is our chosen goal, and we wanted to hire women in senior tech, not just at a grad level. It was quite okay to hire women between 0 to 2 years experience, but a little difficult once it comes to senior level, right? So we wanted to figure out how do we attract this crowd. There are people, one is of course people on break who have to come back, there's other set of people who are also working in other companies and places, and how do you talk about us and tell ThoughtWorks is a great place for women in tech and for people to come back, come and work with us. We brainstormed and came up with a program called Talk Tech to Her. Talk Tech to Her, it was a specific program what we launched to attract women in tech for the senior roles, mid senior to senior roles. And what we focused on in this program was we didn't want to talk about the tangible benefits. Like, those are the, tickets to the game. Like, you have a good maternity policy of 6 months, flexible working hours, work from home, bring your kids to work, So those, that is like a given now in most of the companies. So what we focused on was on the intangibles. We wanted to focus on something, what is there in within ThoughtWorks, which all the women look forward to. Like, for example, now being gender blind, how do you have an equal voice in all your meetings, when you do your projects, how do you have an equal voice? How do we treat women no differently from men when we are assigning any projects or for recognitions or for promotions? How do we give, make the gender pay gap? How do we narrow the gender pay gap? What all are we going to do? Those are the non-tangible benefits, respect, a safe working place. So those were the areas what we focused on to talk about when we spoke about how nice it is to work at ThoughtWorks or what kind of space ThoughtWorks offers for women. And that was, helped us get a lot of good women candidates, interested in ThoughtWorks. The senior women, the mid people who are in the mid career range, mid senior level range as well, up the 5+ years of experience. So we focused on that and talked to her. Was a very successful program for us, a marketing initiative, what we did. And that is what we figured, like all the women, we interviewed a lot of women in tech from outside, people working in the industry, on what do they want, what do they look forward to, other than the usual tangible benefits what they get. And a lot of them talked about being sidelined because there were women not being given assignments, assuming that, yeah, you're a young mother, so you cannot do this because this assignment requires you to put in more hours of work, or this assignment or a project requires to be on calls late in the night or early in the mornings, right? And people just assume it. So we talked about how you have to be gender blind, that women will do, they'll figure out. We give them the right space, give them the right role models in the company, give them the right policies and benefits, then it will automatically happen. So we focused on this in the marketing program, and that really helped us. And also when we were doing this program, it was a lot of learning for us as well. We figured out what women really want at workplace other than the tangible benefits. And the second thing was also about the women who want to come back to work, the women in tech who want to come back to work. So we relaunched Vapsi after this program because we had just started it in a small manner, and then we hadn't done too much work around that. And that has become a full-fledged program for us. And we have hired, over 70 to 80 women right now in the last 3 or 4 years. And we started with looking for only developers, but now we've hired in other areas as well. With test engineers and many other roles as well within the company, tech roles, right? So Vapsi is really a very successful program, and it was completely conceptualized, designed, and it is driven and done by thought workers. People volunteer to be on this program to teach, aside from the project work for this 5 weeks or 6 weeks, and mentor and train women and help them come back to work.
Okay. Thank you, Savita. So, Shivali,
I'll just like to add a few things. So, not so much about being able to advertise it. So, of course, there are multiple initiatives that the sourcing teams take to be able to, whether to take off the names from the resumes and when they share the resumes with the line managers, such that the gender bias does not come into play. And of course, considering that we have the kind of sponsorship we have, line managers want to be seen pro diversity. So that always tends to be to be an advantage, that if they are ever going to be saying that, I don't want to be able to look at women or the other communities, they know that it's not going to be seen in the right light where they're concerned. So that kind of already works in our favor. But what we've done in many of our policies, and I'm sure lots of other organizations are doing, is neutralizing the policy itself. So from calling it a caregiver policy, a maternity policy, or for that matter, when we have a caregiver policy whereby a caregiver can travel with the mother in the first year along with the child because she's taking on a travel plan which is needed from an organization perspective. We have made them more gender neutral by calling them primary caregiver and secondary caregiver. So the paternity policy would be called a secondary caregiver policy. And if it is, you know, like same-sex partners, then depending on the role that they are playing in the caregiving with the child, they're able to avail the policy that they need to be able to avail of. And that kind of takes away, because a lot of these concerns we have started to see already emerge, which is when the men start to say that, you know, you're trying to mollycoddle or nurture women a bit much, and what about us? And why should we take on tougher roles? And why should we take on late night calls? Because in our scenario, a lot of these roles are in sales. And then sometimes you don't want to send the lady late in the evening to a place to tackle a situation. And that's when the bias starts to play in. So the thought has been that all the policies, if we are able to keep them more neutral, as long as the role is being played by the individual, can I kind of activate and ensure that the person receives the benefit that the person requires? That has helped us in good stead in building more programs and building them in the foundation as we move forward.
Okay. Thanks, Shashafali. So I think it's really great to hear the company going out of the way to think about, you know, to segment it, each of it, and bringing in a systematic-led business approach to create a, you know, diverse diversity and inclusion in the with our employees. So it's really great to hear. And so also organization today are, you know, focusing on bringing creating global global program supporting the LGBTQ community. So can you please share, you know, how what are the regional challenges that you face in your organization while implementing this, and how do you tackle that, those kind of challenges? So Nenis, I would be great if to hear your view on this, please.
Yeah, so, you know, at Intuit, the challenges are very less because a leader, some of them who are come out, are driving these initiatives, right? Like I said, Scott Beth, who's a diversity and inclusion leader, who has come out and he's you know, talking about this in not just Intuit but outside, he's a great ambassador for us. And he has been sharing and cascading you know, how a culture should be. I mean, one of the reasons why we won the Great Place to Work in India, number one, one of the thing is culture, right? And it is driven from the leadership team. So it is important that the leaders drive and, you know, walk the talk of what we're doing. But we do have certain challenges in India. I don't deny it. One, like what Savita and Shefali said, awareness is one. The challenge of the fright, no, you know, how do I come out? What do people think? From a culture perspective, India is still, you know, not very open as a Western or, you know, from a European culture, US culture perspective. So the more we provide them that platform, the more we give them that opportunity, and the more the support we provide, we see a lot of people coming out. Said that, some of the challenges what we have here is, you know, is our organization ready in India specifically? Are our hiring managers ready to accept? Like Shefali said, we were thinking of removing the name and just giving the resume. Will the hiring managers, just looking at the profile, will they hire? So we're thinking on those lines. I've also had managers coming back and say, hey, why are you giving me women profile? I don't need. You know, while we talk about LGBT, we also look at from our people with disability, right? That's another area we focus on. So we look at overall and we kind of give them an opportunity to come and say, hey, what is that we want to do? So we have created a forum with people with LGBT background, allies, coming together and said, what is that we need to do from a challenge perspective? How do we remove roadblocks, not just for employees, but also for future employees like candidates? How do we use NOL as a channel to talk to the LGBT community outside and tell what is that we are doing? How is that we are providing this platform? What are the opportunities what we are giving internally? So that's the route we are taking. It is, you know, it is that we see a lot of challenges in terms of people coming out and accepting it. We see challenge of LGBT community people coming out and say, hey, we are open, we are gay, we are lesbian, whatever it is, you know, we still see that because in the culture or in the society, some people still see it as a stigma. So that is a reason why we see that happening. The more organizations are giving them the opportunity, saying that we accept you as whatever you are, come join us. That is going to change this. I know Godrej is leading in that way a lot more than some of our organizations here.
I think plus one to Dennis, I think the cultural issues are very high in at least in India region. The homophobia, what is in the society, is extremely high. So I think there's a long way to go for us in overcoming all these challenges. Thankfully, we have the legislation in place. Article 377 has been revoked, so there's far more acceptance now. But I think organizations like what Intuit is doing or what Godrej is doing is going to really help in the long way. But when people talk about why do we have to only support them or have pro-women policies and men feel marginalized, the only answer what I have for them is that, you know, we're trying to solve a 10,000-year-old problem. This is not a problem of today, right? Women being women having issues, or that's LGBTQ and other issues. This is such an old problem, and definitely everybody should put more force and more legislation and more awareness around it for anything to change or for things to move the needle.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So, Sivishu, I'd like to add a little bit on this one to say that, you know, everything is hunky-dory is not the truth. Because there are challenges, and probably that's why one has a job and is going to continue to have the job that we have. I think when you talked about the regional piece, you know, similar to what Savita was mentioning, that you know, they have the program which is Intern with Pride. We started something called Godrej Gig, where under the umbrella of which we started Project Rainbow and Project Enable, saying that can we, because all the time to be able to get resources to how do I bring more of the community to my workplace, and keeping merit of the job in perspective was not coming through fully, because one also has to keep the productivity hat on at times, and finding the balance was not coming through. We said that let me start the internship program, and it was a both-way story. One, to say that can we give that opportunity to some of the community employees, and two, can I also have that informally alleviate some of the biases that the managers may have as you're working together? If it works through, great, and they can get absorbed into the organization, or else at least we've helped them build some repertoire on their resume to help them find roles outside. Now, as we were building on the program, I wanted to go back into the regions, because again, these are roles which are at junior levels, and those may not always be at the headquarter, which is where we are, say, in Bombay, and we think, you know, like everybody understands the language we speak. I visited plants in Madhya Pradesh, in Rajasthan, in UP, and then I have to ask the HR that, you know, are you sure that if I kind of hire the community, will it get affiliation? Will you be able to, you know, include them in the environment? And sometimes I got answers which were saying that, no, I don't think it's going to be possible. Or the fact that we may be able to do with people, we may be able to absorb and include people with disabilities, but I may not be able to do that with the LGBTQ community. Versus in the Northeast, I found the answer to be the other way around, saying that, you know, with the LGBTQ, we may be able to make an effort because the environment is much more open and they've been used to it. So now one is having to look at this very regionally, because and so to your question, the distinctions exist, and also practicality. So I went to the Northeast, and if I see plants of mine where it's a four-floor building, and if I say, oh, please, can you put up a ramp? And they will be like, you know, it's going to be a cost and I can't put up a four-floor ramp. I know for a fact that I may not be able to make it conducive to people with disability. And this is in the interiors of closer to Sikkim and so on. So therefore, will I then work with LGBTQ community to say, so there's a project that I'm trying to work on to say, can I make an entire shift floor of France employees as well, so that the inclusion is better, communication is better, and so that they can also sustain and survive together, and then we can look at what those productivity metrics are like and then share with the larger organization. So there are these small little experiments that one keeps trying at different points in times, but one has to be very, very conducive and aware of the challenges that may exist in a particular region. Because many a times we talk a lot about Godrej, say, being very friendly. But when I sometimes go and ask an employee, you know, in that interior of my organization, so do you know about the LGBTQ community? And they look at me and say, what is that? And then you realize that, you know, I have a really long way to go to ensure everyone understands and is able to reach this. So, I mean, to be fair, it's not always a great story, and you're still building on it and continuously making more people aware and ensuring that we can offer a more inclusive environment and every through the journey.
I think plus one to Shefali, I think those are very, very valid points, because by bringing people of the community inside organization and not having a inclusive work culture might do more harm than good. Right? We may feel happy about statistics, but it might really work, may not work in their favor. So I think a very holistic approach for meeting all these milestones and our targets is very important in this, and being extremely sensitive about this.
Okay. Thank you, Savita. I think we have covered a good amount of questions, like right from starting from what are the different sources we leverage us to, you know, how do we build an inclusive culture? So I had really an insightful session, and I'm sure all the participants also would definitely have similar kind of experience. So we have some of the questions. So it's open to all the panelists, and anyone can take it up. So we have first question from Shruti. What are the different platforms used to hire an LGBTQ in technology?
So I can take that question, then probably
sure,
Savita, Ashafa. We don't have a specific platform for LGBTQ. We use our career site, we use something called license at Intuit for application tracking system. And we partner with some of our agencies who are specifically focused on LGBT community, like the Pride Circle. You know, the first Pride Circle webinar was there in Bangalore, and we hired a couple of people from those job fairs, right? But specifically, if you look at platform. I don't see any platform in India who has specifically opened and said, hey, I am LGBT or I'm a lesbian. That option is not given. We have been fighting with organizations like LinkedIn, Naukri, but none of them have come out with that. So if you ask me if there is any platform, I don't see. But there are partners, there are NGOs, there are training institutes where we partner with to hire such people.
I think Dennis is right, but there are certain organizations which are also organizing these career fairs conferences where you can meet people from the community for hiring. There was one event called Curious, which was conducted last year by a company called Stockroom. We partner with them and we did participate in that. It was the very first time, so we really didn't look for much for getting more numbers, but we wanted to explore them. Then I also heard that they are launching a website or a job board called Equiv, equiv.in. It's still in the nascent stages, but their focus is on getting people from this community and also women and others on this job portal. So there are a few people who are making attempts, and I think it will gather speed in the few months and the few years that goes by.
The biggest company which does job fairs for LGBTQ community is Pride Circle. So anyone planning to hire with this community, or anyone wants to check what is the availability of talent pool, please reach out to Srini or Ram from Pride Circle. They are the right set of people to consult.
And Curious is also a good forum. That's a good platform as well. It is Q-RIOUS. It is a good platform. They have been pretty successful in organizing. It is pretty new, but they're doing a fairly good job.
Okay. Thanks, Anita. Okay, so we have one another interesting question from Tushar. So after a sensitization training on employees around diversity and inclusion, how do we ascertain its effectiveness post sensitization training?
That's a great question. You know, Tushar, what we do at Intuit, I can share. You know, we have you know, certain trainings which we conduct over a period of time, and these are mandatory trainings, and people do have to take you know, there is a regular interval where these people employees have to take up this training, and managers also goes through certain training. Sensitization is one of the things, and we kind of make sure the manager holds responsible in terms of taking sure that the team is, you know, from a culture perspective, are following certain, you know, code of conduct, or even for example, for that matter, how are employees treating another employee, right? Because culture is the biggest thing for Intuit. So we, and considering that we do have LGBT community at Intuit, you know, we make sure that employees follow that, and there is no discrimination happening at any level, at any gender. So that is closely checked and monitored by the managers. And then of course we have HR business partners who closely work with the employees. And if they see any kind of such issues, you know, there is always counseling, or there is always, you know, open to talk. In fact, we have counselors coming every 2 weeks, you know, for employees to go share their concern. It can be an LGBT employee, or it can be an ally, whoever it is. It's a confidential discussion which they have with consultants. So that's another thing which we do. If there is any problem with employees, we constantly share information about challenges, or what's working well, what's not working well in this community. And we kind of tell the employees how to support, you know, the community, or if they need, any ally need any kind of support, any kind of counseling, we are open to it. So that's how we've been doing, and so far we have not had any challenges in terms of discrimination as such.
Okay.
Yeah, this discrimination is something which is kind of non-negotiable for us. So people don't, I mean, that's simply not tolerated. There's zero tolerance for that, and that is driven from the top itself, by way of policies, by way of having D&I teams, communities, where people have, we have an open door policy where people can go and talk about it if they face such discrimination at the workplace. So yeah, like as Dennis said, I think it's a continuous, it's a journey, it's a continuous work what we need to do in that space.
Okay. So hi, Dennis, I think this, so there is one other question. Does ThoughtWorks provide such non-tech option for women on career break who do not have tech background? Please share the contact link if you have any, if you have as a part of diversity from Kalai.
So in ThoughtWorks right now we are focusing more on women in tech, but for all the non-tech jobs, we are open to hire, we are always open to hire women. The programs what we have done is specifically for training in tech, but please feel free to apply to any of our jobs, and we will take it forward from there. But we do not have a program as such for the non-tech, you know, women.
Okay.
Because more than 80% of our jobs, or 85%, is more in tech. But in a non-tech space, in leadership roles, we typically look to hire more women.
Okay.
Just to add, Shushri, at Intuit, we have something called Intuit Again. Similar to ThoughtWorks there. So what we do is we hire people who have taken a break, women in tech, and we provide them a 6 months internship where we pay them a 1.25 lakhs internship to every intern. And they go through a similar internship like any college student would go through, because we feel someone who's coming back with a break would require handholding at least for six months. Considering we are a product organization. And then what we do is we convert them into an employee. So that has been a success, and which we started in India. Now that project has gone global, and people in the US are doing a similar program, not just in the US, but also in UK. So anyone who is interested, please reach out to me. I can connect them to the team who is running this program.
Okay, sure, Dennis. So we have one last question. Before that, we'll have a quick announcement. So I'm sure all the participants have enjoyed the session thoroughly. So please do share our feedback in Mentimeter, because it will be definitely helpful for us to, you know, to know what are the things that is going on well, also the areas of improvement. So definitely it would be really a great help for us. So one last question. So it's from Shiva. How do they ensure that people of diverse mindset gain entry and they are engaged and developed? Any best practices?
Sorry, can you say the question again? What was that?
Sure. Sure, Savita. So how do they ensure that people of diverse mindsets gain entry and are engaged and developed, and any best practices?
Okay.
I can take this question.
Yeah.
Sure, Dennis.
Well, go ahead. You can do it.
No, you can do that, Ganesh. I'll add on to it. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, for any organization, the entry is the criteria which any organization keeps is, you know, if it is a technical requirement, it has to be the technology, or if it has to be a non-tech, it has to be either HR or, you know, whatever it is. That is the entry to any organization, whether you're a LGBTQ or you're people with disability or you're ally, because every organization has criteria is, do you fit in the organization from a requirement perspective? Since you are coming from a diverse background, doesn't mean the bar will reduce. That is not going to happen in the organization, right? So you'll have to be prepared and, you know, very strong in your skills of what you're applying to. So that is the entry level.
Okay.
And once you join any organization, each organization has its ways of training employees, their culture, their policies would be aligned to LGBTQ or people with disability or ally or whatever it is, right? So that is the way the organization functions. And if you look at companies like Intuit, we have a very strong training team, which helps the employees to, from a technical and non-tech perspective, from a growth perspective, and also from an LGBT perspective, we have certain training inbuilt for specifically Intuit employees, which every employee should go through to understand what is the culture of the organization, what is the do's and don'ts. So that way you are imbibed with the culture of the organization. And that will also help in employees' growth mindset. You know, you have internal mobility opportunity at Intuit. One of the, you know, the policy what we have is once you join the company, the next day you are eligible to apply to any other organization within Intuit. You're also eligible to apply to any other location globally if you would like to, you know, if you think you are a fit for those organizations. That way you're taking care of the growth. We have mentors in the organization. We have leadership team who are coaches for the employees who would like to, you know, coached and, you know, picked up and see what is that your developing areas are. So these are organizational policies and process which they follow. So every organization has its own thing, but the criteria to join any organization is the skill set what the organization requires. That is the most important thing.
Yeah, so I think a big plus one to what Dennis has said, I think the entry criteria is not going to change. They're not going to lower the bar or have a separate reservation policy for people. But then, having said that, all organizations, most of the organizations have support systems. Likewise, I said, when we are bringing women back to work, we make sure that we give them a training, that we make them go through internship. Only then we assist them to see if they are fit to get a full-time job with us. So while the entry criteria does not change, we try our best to provide a level playing field for everyone who come in, a way of supporting people from diverse background who may not have the privilege or who may not have those background like the other people who come into the organization. But once they come in, they are just treated like any other employees. All the different policies, benefits, training programs are applicable to them, and we make sure that we provide extra support to them if required so that they can sustain and grow in the organization.
Okay. Thank you, Samita. So I believe we have come to the end of the session. We are almost 10 minutes ahead of time. So I thoroughly personally enjoyed speaking to Shefali, Savita, and Dennis. It's been a lot of informative and insightful session. And also I would like to thank NHRD for giving me the opportunity to be the moderator. So special thanks to Pallavi and Mitch for supporting the entire program from the starting. And so over to Mitch for the closing note.
Thank you, Shivashri. Great session. A lot of insights that came across, hearing Shefali, Savita, and Dennis. Thanks so much, Shefali, Savita, and Dennis, for accepting this request and being on our panel. We started with about over 200 people, and we're just on about 50% now, just at the closing of it. Before we sign off, one last sentence or a statement that you would like to share with the community in terms of when they are looking at designing the entire process of inclusive hiring. What is one thing that you would suggest or one thing that we need to keep in mind?
It should be holistic is what I would say. Just having metrics and milestones is not the end of it. While you have it, make sure that you go in baby steps and have a more holistic approach, and also think about what you will do once they come into the organization. Just hiring them is just the tip of the iceberg, but there's a long, long journey once you hire them.
Thank you, Savita. Shefali?
Actually, I would agree with Savita that it needs to be very holistic. And I would think if you're starting with the whole piece on inclusion, then I don't want to tag them and, put a star on any community and say, what, you belong to this particular quota in my structure. Right. Merit is very important and we want to keep that bar. So it is tough love. It's one of our EVPs, which is to say that, we will be tough. We will give feedback and it has to be consistent across. So it won't be any different for anyone. So keeping the bar in terms of performance and standard and expectations high, and yes, still providing the nurturing and environment that any individual needs. So customize, yet keep it broad in terms of how we include and how we provide them an authentic self and a whole self avenue and a space.
Thank you, Shefali. Dennis?
I would say as a talent acquisition person, don't have any biasness when you look at certain profiles of a certain gender or a certain group. One. Second, I would say understand each community, because as a recruiter, if you don't understand that, you will not be able to understand the profile. So you need to be aware of that, because end of the day, you are a salesperson who is selling a role to hiring manager as well as to the candidate. So that is very important that you understand each community. Like Savita said, hiring is just one thing. Keeping connected to those communities when they join your organization is very important as a talent acquisition team, because if people are not happy and they are leaving, then you will not be able to attract talent from that community. So it is very important for you to be connected and use them as an ambassador. When you have to hire people with similar background, or when you have to go to colleges or to have some job fair, because it's important to show from an external world perspective what his organization is made of. So that is very important. So that is what I would say.
Thank you, Dennis. Thank you, everyone, for being a part of our monthly meet. We will meet again next week. month, same day, same time. Our monthly meet timing remains the same, 7 to 8:30 p.m. A lot of different webinars, learning programs lined up. To log in to our website and our social media handles to know what's coming next for you. Thank you so much and good night.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Thanks for joining.
Thank you.
Bye.
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 Thank you. Bye.